Good morning, everyone. Glad you found us for our online worship, and happy Mother's Day to all of you mothers that are out there today tuning in and watching our online worship service. Remember, please take a moment to sign in your attendance using the QR code. You guys have been doing a really good job of doing that. I've been noticing a little uptick in people that have been watching that way, and I appreciate that. It's great. I see that every single week. And if you're at home and not feeling great, and you stayed home, which is what we want you to do, we certainly hope that you get to feeling better quickly, and then we'll get you back here at St. Stephen too. So again, happy Mother's Day to all you mothers that are out there. Today we're going to look at Romans chapter 2 as we continue our Romans trek through the lectionary throughout this summer months. We pray that you would that would be a blessing to you as we dive into God's Word deeper, especially God's Word written through the hand of St. Paul to the Christians that were in Romans in Rome, which is great for us too. Let's get going with our opening song.
Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. With all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with all your strength. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. I will serve the Lord with all my heart, with all my soul, with all my mind, and with all my strength. I will serve the Lord with all my heart, with all my soul, with all my mind, and with all my strength. With all my heart, with all my soul, with all my mind, with all my strength. I will serve the Lord with all my heart, with all my soul, with all my mind, and with all my strength. With all my heart, with all my soul, with all my mind, with all my strength, with all my heart, with all my soul, with all my mind, with all my strength. I will love you, Lord, with all my heart, with all my soul, with all my mind, and with all my strength. I will love you, Lord, with all my heart, with all my soul, with all my mind, with all my strength. I will love you, Lord, with all my heart, with all my soul, with all my mind, and with all my strength.
We'll continue by praying Luther's morning prayer. I thank you, my heavenly Father, through Jesus Christ, your dear Son, that you have kept me this night from all harm and danger. And I pray that you would keep me this day also from sin and every evil, that all my doings and life may please you. For into your hands I commend myself, my body and soul and all things. Let your holy angel be with me, that the evil foe may have no power over me. Amen. We make our beginning in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We read responsibly sections of Psalm 66. Bless our God, O peoples, let the sound of his praise be heard, who has kept our soul among the living and has not let our feet slip. For you, O God, have tested us. You have tried us as silver is tried. You brought us into the net. You laid a crushing burden on our backs. You let men ride over our heads. We went through the fire and through the water, yet you have brought us out to a place of abundance. I will come into your house with burnt offerings. I will perform my vows to you. That which my lips uttered and my mouth promised when I was in trouble, I will offer to you burnt offerings of fatted animals, with the smoke of the sacrifice of rams. I will make an offering of bulls and goats. Come and hear, all you who fear God, and I will tell what he has done for my soul. I cried to him with my mouth, and high praise was on my tongue. If I had cherished iniquity in my heart, the Lord would not have listened. But truly God has listened. He has attended to the voice of my prayer. Blessed be God, because he has not rejected my prayer or removed his steadfast love from me. We continue with our confession and forgiveness. Let us confess our sins to God, our merciful Father. Almighty God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, Maker of all things, Judge of all people, we admit and confess our sinfulness. We have turned away from each other in our thinking, speaking, and doing. We have done the evil you forbid and have not done the good you demand. We repent and are truly sorry for these our sins. Have mercy on us, kind Father, because of the obedience of our brother, Jesus Christ, your Son. Forgive us all that is past, and with the power of the Holy Spirit, move us to serve you faithfully. Set our feet upon a new path of life, and build your kingdom here among us. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. And hear the good news of our loving Heavenly Father, for he indeed has had mercy upon us and has sent his Son Jesus to die for us. So in the stead and by the command of my Savior Jesus Christ, I forgive you all of your sin in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
We know less days. First reading for the sixth Sunday after Easter comes from Acts chapter 17. While Paul was waiting for them at Athens, his spirit was provoked within him as he saw that the city was full of idols. So he reasoned in the synagogues with the Jews and the devout persons, and in the marketplace every day with those who happened to be there. Some of the Epicurean and Stoic philosophers also conversed with him, and some said, "What does this babbler wish to say?" Others said, "He seems to be a preacher of foreign divinities," because he was preaching Jesus and the resurrection. And they took hold of him and brought him to the Areopagus and said, "May we know what this new teaching is that you are presenting? For you bring some strange things to our ears. We wish to know, therefore, what these things mean." Now all of the Athenians and the foreigners who lived there would spend their time in nothing except telling or hearing something new. So Paul, standing in the midst of the Areopagus, said, "Men of Athens, I perceive that in every way you are very religious. For as I passed along and observed the objects of your worship, I found also an altar with the inscription, 'To the unknown God.' What therefore you worship as unknown, this I proclaim to you: the God who made the world and everything in it, being Lord of heaven and earth, does not live in temples made by man, nor is he served by human hands as though he needed anything, since he himself gives to all mankind life and breath and everything. And he made from one man every nation of mankind to live on all the face of the earth, having determined allotted periods and boundaries of their dwelling place, that they should seek God, in the hope that they might feel their way toward him and find him. Yet he is actually not far from each one of us, for in him we live and move and have our being, as even some of your own poets have said, 'For we are indeed his offspring.' Being then God's offspring, we ought not to think that the divine being is like gold or silver or stone, an image formed by the art and imagination of man. The time of ignorance God overlooked, but now he commands all people everywhere to repent, because he has fixed a day on which he will judge the world in righteousness by a man whom he has appointed. And of this he has given assurance to all by raising him from the dead." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. The epistle reading and basis of the sermon this week is from Romans chapter 2. "Therefore you have no excuse, O man, every one of you who judges, for in passing judgment on another, you condemn yourself, because you, the judge, practice the very same things. We know that the judgment of God rightly falls on those who do such things. Do you suppose, O man, you who judge those who do such things and yet do them yourself, that you will escape the judgment of God? Or do you presume on the riches of his kindness and forbearance and patience, not knowing that God's kindness is meant to lead you to repentance? But because of your hard and impenitent heart, you are storing up wrath for yourself on the day of wrath, when God's righteous judgment will be revealed. He will render to each one according to his works. To those who by patience and in well-doing seek glory and honor and immortality, he will give eternal life. But for those who are self-seeking and do not obey the truth, but obey unrighteousness, there will be wrath and fury. There will be tribulation and distress for every human being who does evil, the Jew first and also the Greek, but honor and glory and peace for everyone who does good, the Jew first and also the Greek, for God shows no partiality." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Joy of the Lord is
to you, online viewers, chosen by our Heavenly Father for His good purposes in this life, empowered by the Holy Spirit for obedience to our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, grace and peace be to you. So the title of today's sermon, God's Kindness. And boy, don't we have a kind God for sure. Because it doesn't matter what we've done, what we've been, what we've said, whatever, God loves us in Christ Jesus. Not for who we are, that is, His perfect child or His pretty good child or even His naughty child. None of those reasons make Him love us. He just has an undying love for us because that's who God is. God is love, and God loves you and me. In fact, we're told in the Bible, right? God so loved the world that He sent His Son Jesus to die on a cross for our sins. That is the Father's love for you and for me. God shows His kindness to you and me that while we're yet sinners, Christ died for us. We love those words in Romans 5, verses 7 and 8, where they talk about that, and we see that sweet gospel promise. And, well, that's what we got to look forward in our Romans series for sure. But today, Romans chapter 2, well, that's a little bit more challenging for you and for me. Because in this text, we pick up the challenging teaching of God's law being applied to the life of the believer. Remember, St. Paul is writing to the Christians in Rome. And when we read Romans 2, well, God is writing and speaking to you and to me as His dearly beloved children, as His loved children, those that are already in His family. So this gets to be challenging, right? And I actually had a lot of fun. So I appreciate we've got this Right Now Media. And if you haven't subscribed to that, please take that moment to get subscribed to that because I sure appreciated interacting with you. There was a little challenge that I threw out to you to read Romans 2 and answer a question specifically to God's law and how you see that being applied in your life. And I'll tell you what, that helps me out a real bunch as I'm preparing my message for Sunday morning. And so again, thank you for those that participated in that and gave me some feedback because it really helps me sort those kind of things out. So Luther's Small Catechism, especially when we pick it up at question number 10, what are the two great doctrines of the Bible? Law and gospel are the two great doctrines of the Bible. We must sharply distinguish between the law and the gospel in order to understand the Bible rightly. Question 11, what is the difference between the law and the gospel? The law teaches what we are to do and not to do. The gospel teaches what God has done and still does in Jesus for our salvation. The law shows us our sin and the wrath of God. The gospel shows us our Savior and brings God's grace and favor. The law must be proclaimed to all people, but especially to sinners who refuse to repent. And the gospel must be proclaimed to sinners who are troubled by their sin. And in that catechism, Romans is quoted a couple times right there in that particular section. As a seminary student, I remember one of the classes we had to take was the Lutheran mind, and one of the topics we took up was God's law and gospel. And when I had to do my first preaching class, well, we had to go through this book, The Proper Distinction Between Law and Gospel by C.F. W. Walther. A great text indeed, and we had to go through each and every one of them, and we sort of highlighted and commented throughout the book to interact with this great truth, this important thing that takes place. And if that's not enough for you in understanding the challenge that this actually can bring in Scripture, we, even at our pastor's conference this past Thursday, spent a little bit of time talking about law and gospel and its proper use and how to be able to effectively communicate both the law and the gospel in the preaching task and also in our ministry caring for the flocks of God, those that we are entrusted to. So what an awesome task. But as we dig into Romans chapter 2, we have in what we see a little bit of a challenge on how to rightfully understand God's law and gospel. And it's meant to intentionally challenge us in this way. I think one thing that might be helpful is if we think about the law in this way. Obedience to God's word is worshiping and serving the Creator. Think about that. Obedience to God's word is worshiping and serving the Creator. As a redeemed child of God, as somebody that is already in a right relationship with God, these are good words for me to understand in my relationship with God. I heard one theologian say once that God's love language, right, is obedience. For example, in John 15, verse 10, he writes, "If you keep my commandments," this is Jesus speaking, "you will abide in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love." And in John 15, verse 12 and following, "This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, that someone lays down his life for his friends. You are my friends if you do what I command." And one last one that John records that Jesus said in John 14, "If you love me, you will keep my commandments." One could say a healthy relationship with our Heavenly Father includes his law and instructions for his will in our lives. But thankfully for us, God's relationship with us is never dependent upon how good we are at living our lives for him. This is an extremely odd paradox, but it's clearly spoken to you and to me in scriptures. This just is the way that it is. In Lutheran circles, right, we have a technical term for this aspect of the law. It's called the third use of the law. The third use of the law teaches us Christians what we should and should not do to lead a God-pleasing life. The third use or function of the law is called a guide, right? And we all know what a guide is. A guide is somebody that helps us see the way or helps us find the fish if you're using a guide to help you find fish. So the point is, right, follow the guide. And there is, and I love this one the most, there is a strong connection to the third article of the creed when we talk about the third use of the law. I like this because it strongly connects to Romans 2, verse 29. Remember last week we looked at this verse, and it's also important for us to understand it here too. "For no one is a Jew who is merely one outwardly, nor is circumcision outward and physical, but a Jew is one inwardly, and circumcision is a matter of the heart, by the Spirit, not by the letter." I'll try to put it in Pastor Joe's simple terms, right? I think what St. Paul is saying here is that a child of God does the things that God would have him do. Just like our children, we had rules and regulations and expectations of them as being our child. They maybe didn't always follow those, didn't make them not our child, but the expectation was always there. This is what being a Rodriguez was all about, doing these things and these kinds of expectations. See, I think where we get mixed up is when we try to sort this sort of thing out. But I think the easiest way to think about this is the Nike way, right? Just do it. Do it. Follow the guide. Jesus says, put away what you're doing, pick up your cross and follow me. We've got a great guide, Jesus is our guide. He's our king. He's the one that we want to follow always. Sometimes maybe stories are a better way for teaching us to understand how exactly this shakes out. And I can think of no better story, perhaps, than Moses. Remember Moses? He was born in Egypt. He should have been thrown into the water because he was a Hebrew baby and was supposed to be thrown in because Pharaoh had made that command. Well, fast forward, Moses runs away, right? And he is living in a wilderness far away from the children of Israel. And he comes across a burning bush. Remember that? When he was taking care of some flocks. And he goes up to the burning bush and God says, take off your sandals because you are on holy ground. And then God gives him his plan to rescue the people, his people, from slavery in Egypt. Now Moses gives them all kinds of excuses, gives God all kinds of excuses, and God meets pretty much every one of his demands, in a sense, and his excuses. So finally, Moses is going to be obedient and follow what God has commanded him to do. And on his way, when he was there, we're given this really odd situation in Exodus 4. What's going on? An angel of the Lord shows up to destroy Moses' child. Zipporah calls him a man of blood. The problem? Well, Moses' son was not circumcised. That's something that should have been second nature for Moses as a child of Abraham, or a son of Abraham, a child of God. So what does he have to do? Well, he has to circumcise Moses. Hey, if you're looking for a good girl's name, Zipporah might not be a bad name at all, because Zipporah helped Moses get his ducks in a row before he went to be the leader of God's people. See, the same call is for you and for me in all aspects of our lives. If we're not following what Jesus commands us to do, what God puts in his law, how do we expect anybody else to do the same? We should be leading by example. We should be the ones that are worried about ourselves and not everybody else, but doing what we need to do in order to get our house straight too. So that's why St. Paul can say things like this: but for those who are self-seeking and do not obey the truth, but obey unrighteousness, there will be wrath and fury. You see, our obedience can lead us in the wrong direction. That's for sure. And that's St. Paul's warning to you and to me. Even Jesus says the same sort of things in Matthew's gospel. If we remember Matthew chapter 7, judge not that you be not judged. For with the judgment you pronounce, you will be judged. And with the measure you use, it will be measured against you. Again, this was in those Beatitudes, that Sermon on the Mount that Jesus gave to his followers at that time. Don't be concerned about everybody else. I want you to be concerned with you. What is your role in life? Is it husband? Is it father? Is it grandpa? Is it worker? Well, we pay attention to those places and stations that God has put us in our lives, and we do them to the best of our ability, and also following God's will completely. Because that's who we need to be concerned about in our relationship with God, us and us alone. We don't do any good by comparing ourselves to anybody else. You'll always be able to find somebody that perhaps is doing something worse than you. But the goal is not to be the lowest common denominator to raise up our Christian life to live that way. We focus on us and us alone. Again, you may be hearing these words as a crushing blow. And if that happens, it's no longer the guide speaking to you, but it's the mirror, God's law staring you in the face saying, you have failed. But remember, that mirror reflects Jesus' cross, which says, I got you covered. Jesus died for you. Jesus makes you right before the Heavenly Father. And it always works that way. because our works are not meant to earn our salvation or to earn our right place before God. Only Jesus does that for you and for me. You see, the cross says a better thing for you and for me in every single aspect of our life. And when we understand what Jesus has done for us, we can once again look to God's law in a healthy way. That's what St. Paul's talking about in Romans chapter 2, verses 6 and 7. He will render to each one according to his works, to those who by patience in well-doing seek for glory and honor and immortality, he will give eternal life. We live for obedience because we know what we already have in Christ Jesus our Lord. And we want others to know the same thing too. And we do that when we live our life for Christ, because then we are a reflection of his love in this world. Yes, that's a law thing, but you know what? We are called to obedience. Remember, obedience is God's love language. And when we are obedient, we reflect God's love always. Amen. And now may the peace which surpasses our human understanding guard your hearts and keep your minds in Christ Jesus until life everlasting. Amen. We continue our worship by returning to our Lord a portion of the gifts he has blessed us with and entrusted to us for his kingdom work. We have several giving options for you to utilize. As St. Paul reminds us in 2 Corinthians chapter 9, arrange in advance for the gift you have promised, so that it may be ready as a willing gift, not as an extraction. The point is this: whoever sows sparingly will also reap sparingly, and whoever sows bountifully will also reap bountifully. Each one must give as he has made up his mind, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. And God is able to make all grace abound to you, so that having all contentment in all things at all times, you may abound in every good work. He who supplies seed to the sower and bread for food will supply and multiply your seed for sowing and increase the harvest of your righteousness.
For this week's highlights from the Team Jesus News, our Small Seeds Director, Beth Backus, is retiring after 18 years of service. All congregational members are invited to her open house retirement party on Sunday, May 21st from 1 to 4 p.m. at Corbin Mill in Liberty. Our Team Jesus family-style Bible study will begin on Sunday, May 28th during the educational hour. This family-style Bible study opportunity will take the place of all our regular Sunday school hour classes. We're very excited to be digging into the Bible as a whole family, growing together in God's Word. Finally, Generations Ministry. Terry Gertz, our LCMS Foundation Gift Planning Counselor, will be here on Sunday, June 4th during the education hour and after the second service to provide information and answer questions about estate plan and gift planning. For more information, you can check this week's Team Jesus News.
Praised by all the heavenly hosts.
This week in prayer, Diana Smith has asked us to pray for the friends and family of her cousin Ruth, who's called to join her family in heaven. Marla Rennie has asked us to pray for healing for Pam Witt, who has an infection in her leg. Vicki Kimmel has asked us to pray for her dad, Vic Kimmel, who was undergoing surgery this week. So we pray for a quick and successful recovery. Rosella Caldwell has asked us to continue to pray for her son, Michael, who was hospitalized last week but is out of the hospital and having some tests done. Diana Smith has also asked us to pray for her cousin, Tim, and his family and the loss of his wife, Debbie. And Dave Lanehart has asked us to pray for Willow, a dear friend's little girl with medical problems and possibly leukemia. So we will keep Willow in our prayers. So let us pray for the whole Church of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. O Lord, you bless and protect your people in the world where many false gods, known and unknown, are worshipped. Give your saints a clear and bold proclamation of Jesus Christ. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Heavenly Father, your Son suffered on our behalf to win salvation for us. Grant that we may have the privilege not only of believing in him, but also of suffering for his sake. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord of heaven and earth, you have given the Spirit of truth to dwell in us through holy baptism. Help us daily to remember our baptismal identities, and we celebrate with those who are remembering their baptismal birthdays this week. Grant your Spirit steadfast guidance that the feet of this congregation and catechumens may not slip into sin and unbelief, but live always in praise of you before the world. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Creator, you have made from one man all nations of the earth, and you sustain us. Grant good leaders in every land who will seek peace and serve justice. Frustrate the causes of evil, violence, and oppression. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Father in heaven, you have given us a mirror of your love and the vocation of mothers who nurture, guide, and raise their children in all good things. Bless them in their calling. Sustain them through the weary and difficult times. Remember in compassion all who are barren and bring them comfort through the children of your church. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, you promised not to abandon us in our need, nor leave us as orphans. Send forth your Spirit and work through us, your people, that the lonely, the poor, the homeless, the travelers may rejoice in your presence and the power of your love. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Grant healing according to your will, O Lord, and sustain in faith those for whom we pray, especially Ruth, Pam, Vic, Michael, the family of Ruth, the family of Tim, and Willow. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We give you thanks for the salvation and life you've given us through Jesus Christ. And all these things and whatever else you know that we need, Lord, we ask that you grant it for the sake of him who died and rose again and now lives and reigns with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, our Heavenly Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with and abide with you always. Amen.
In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest trial. Storm, what heights of love, what depths of peace.
In Christ alone, who took on flesh, fullness of God in helpless babe, this gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the ones he came to save.
Can I?